إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. أما بعد، السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Today inshallah we continue with benefiting from the book Akhlaq al-Anbiya by Sheikh Sadhan Hafizahullah, and also continue going through the fiqh of Tahara, purification. The Sheikh said, وَمِنْ أَخْلَاقِ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ عَلَيْهِمُ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ مَعْرِفَةُ حَقِّ الْوَالِدَيْنِ. And from the manners of the Prophets عَلَيْهِمُ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ, knowing the rights of the parents. وَفِي شَأْنِ مَقَامِ الْوَالِدَيْنِ يُقَالِ. And in relation to this topic we should say, لَقَدْ تَهَاوَنَ كَثِيرٌ مِنَ النَّاسِ بِأَمْرِ بِرِّ الْوَالِدَيْنِ وَأَحْمَلُوا شَأْنَهُ وَهَذَا مِنَ الْخُطُورَةِ بِمَكَانِ. That many people unfortunately do not pay due attention to the issue of being dutiful to one's parents, and they neglect those rights, and this is extremely dangerous. فَكَمْ هَدَمَ حُقُوقُ الْوَالِدَيْنِ مِنْ بُيُوتٍ. And how many houses were broken and destroyed due to the fact that people disobeyed their parents. وَكَمْ فَرَّقَ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَزَوْجِهِ. And how many people were divided between them and their wife. وَكَمْ أَفْقَرَ مِنْ أُنَاسٍ. And how many people were rendered or became poor due to the fact that they didn't fulfill their duties towards their parents. وَكَمْ عُذِّبْ بِسَبَبِهِ فِي الدُّنْيَا مِنْ أُنَاسٍ. And how many people were punished in this world, meaning many, were punished in this world because of that. وَحَقُّ الْوَالِدَيْنِ فِي الْآخِرَةِ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ عَظِيمٍ. And of course we have many ayat and hadith. The Sheikh didn't mention them, but he said, because the book is not about just showing those things, but to show how the Prophets عليهم الصلاة والسلام used to have what kind of manners. And we have many, many ayat and hadith. So many people, they have sometimes questions, and this I'm saying from myself, regarding listening to parents and what do you do and how do you actually look after them. Allah said in the Quran very few words about parents, and those words, they actually contain everything that we must do in relation to our parents. Even if your parents or one of them is alive, and they are, even if they are not a Muslim, then we are obliged to be good to them, regardless of their religion or their behavior even. And Allah said, مَعْرُوفًا وَصَاحِبْهُمَا فِي الدُّنْيَا مَعْرُوفًا, and accompany them in a good way in this dunya. So the ulama say when ma'roof is used, generally in the Quran and Sunnah, it means what the good that corresponds to the urf, to the customs of the people. So for example, in one country, it may be ma'roof to kiss the parents when they wake up, and to kiss them when they go to bed. And in another place, maybe it's not from ma'roof, it's normal. So it differs, but generally, that's one thing that Allah said. And also, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. إِحْسَان means every إِحْسَان, every good you can think of, you should try and do for them. حُقُوقُ الْوَالِدَيْنِ, which means the disobeying the parents, the scholars talked about it, and they said that it means to disobey and not to do what they wish you to do. And if it is wajib in Islam, then the sin is more, because you have disobeyed Allah and disobeyed the parents. Just like a wife who doesn't obey her husband if he tells her to do wajib. Like if the parents say to the person to pray 5 times, the obligatory prayers, and he or she, they don't pray. Or they tell the girl to wear hijab, proper hijab, and she doesn't do, then the sin becomes worse. And if something is mustahab, not wajib, not obligatory, because this is from fiqh, ikhwan, of understanding the ahkam of sharia. If something is mustahab, but the parent says to do it, it becomes wajib. So for example, to pray two rak'ah after Maghrib or Isha is mustahab. But the father says you must pray. Or pray, salli. Then the person must pray. Why? Because it comes under the general ayat and ahadith that tell us to obey the parents. What if it is something that is permissible? For example, let's say in food or in getting married or something, because marriage is permissible. Many ulama consider it mustahab. The majority, they consider it mustahab, and they only consider it wajib if the person is fearing to fall into haram, the majority of scholars. Or eating some kind of food. So the parents say, eat bananas, they're good for you. Generally, if we don't have any natural aversion to bananas or allergies, we should listen to them. And these are things that sometimes cause problems for no reason. Or they tell us, go and buy something. And of course, most of the time that something is halal. So if that thing is haram, then of course we can't listen to them. But we can't be rude to them. What if something is makruh and they tell us to do it? In that case, we have to see. If that makruh can lead to haram, then we have to apologize and say we can't do it. Because it can lead to haram. But if we think it will not lead to haram, then maybe we can do, but we have to explain that it's not good to do. Because makruh means Allah doesn't like it, but it's not reached the stage of haram. That's generally, and if parents say something, the scholars, many of them said, just to play around. Some parents, they want to show their power. And they say, go there, do this, but they don't really mean to. So, if there is benefit for them and no harm for us, we do it. So if the parents say, divorce your wife, it happens a lot, unfortunately. Very often the reason given is not sufficient, especially by the mother-in-law of the lady. She may dislike how she cooks or how she looks or whatever else or something. But her son loves and she doesn't have problems in the deen or akhlaq. Because the Prophet ﷺ stipulated in the marriage what? Deen means the person must fear Allah. We must see it from that person. Or khuluq, which is manners. Khuluq is from deen, but because it's so important, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned it separately. So we don't find that she, this lady, goes out without permission of the husband or goes at night somewhere and we don't know where she went. Or she talks to men on the phone. We don't find that she's like this. And we find that she treats her husband's parents very well. Because this is from treating your husband well. If you shout at my parents and you say, I love you, that's not really good. So from treating the husband well is to treat his parents well, or from treating the wife well is to treat her parents well. So if they say to divorce her and we don't have anything, generally in a Muslim country it can be referred to the qada, to the court. But in a non-Muslim country, what do? We have not much choice. We keep going around and try to reconcile. Therefore, the parents also must fear Allah not to. So this is, we're talking about the prophets, how they were with their parents, alayhi salatu wasalam. So the Shaykh gave examples from the Quran. He said, Nuh alayhi salam qal, Rabbi ghfir li wa li walidayhi. Nuh said, as we have in Surah Nuh, alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, my Lord forgive me and my parents. وَكَانَا مُسْلِمَيْنَ. Of course they were Muslims, because otherwise you can't ask for forgiveness for non-Muslim parents, as we shall see coming. يَحْيَى عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامُ قَالَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ وَبَرَّا بِوَالِدَيْهِ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ جَبَّارًا عَصِيًّا. When he described يَحْيَى, Allah, he said he will be pious and good to his parents, and he would not be arrogant and disobedient to Allah. Isa alayhi salam, he said, وَبَرَّا بِوَالِدَتِي, because he didn't have a father, so he said, Allah told me to be good to my mother. سليمان عليه الصلاة والسلام قال ربي أوزعني أن أشكر نعمتك التي أنعمت علي وعلى والدي. من سورة النمل, the ants. Allah told us the dua of سليمان عليه السلام. He said, Oh my Lord, enable me, give me ways to be grateful to you for your favors which you have bestowed upon me and upon my parents. And of course the father of سليمان, as we know, was داود عليه السلام. يوسف عليه السلام كان بارا بيعقوب. His father, Yusuf was father of, his father was يعقوب عليه السلام. So in Surah Yusuf, Allah said, فلما دخلوا على يوسف آوى إليه أبويه وقال ادخلوا مصر إن شاء الله آمنين ورفع أبويه على العرش. When the whole problem of Yusuf concluded towards the end of Surah Yusuf, Allah said, when they entered upon Yusuf, all of the family, he brought his parents close to himself. And he said to the whole family, enter Egypt by the will of Allah in peace and security. And he raised his parents, or he puts them upon the throne to show them respect and love. And Yaqub alayhi salam kana barran bi Ishaq. And of course Yusuf has a very beautiful lineage. That's why the Prophet ﷺ, when he was asked, he said Yusuf is the best of people. Because the Sahaba asked him, who are the best of people? He said Yusuf, because he is son of a prophet and son of a prophet, son of a Khalil, who is Ibrahim. Because Yaqub, his father was Ishaq, and Ishaq, his father was Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. And the Sheikh said here, Ismail Ishaq kana darraini bi Ibrahim. Ismail, of course, they are the sons of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. They were very obedient to Ibrahim. And of course we can mention the case of Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam. The Sheikh didn't mention it, I will mention it. How was Ismail obedient to Ibrahim alayhi salam? Why do we do Hajj and Umrah and we slaughter the sheep or the cow or the camel? As you know, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he saw a dream that he was slaughtering his son, and that was Ismail. And Ismail alayhi salam, he didn't say to him no, he said do what you have been ordered, because the dreams of prophets are revelation from Allah, wahi we call it in Arabic. I mean, that is some of the greatest. Nowadays we say to our children, go buy something they don't want, because they're so busy with the internet. They say there is no life after Wi-Fi. If they leave Wi-Fi, that's it. Life stops, some people think. But it has been proven that there is life without internet. Alhamdulillah. It's good news. So, in case someone didn't know. So Ismail alayhi salatu wasalam, he was, and we will see other things about Ismail. And Ismail was a great man, and Ishaq and Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. So Ibrahim we will see now. وإبراهيم كان بارا بأبيه أعظم البر وهو كافر. Because Ibrahim's father was a kafir, not Muslim. And despite that, in Surah Maryam, Allah described what he said to him when he was talking to him, and of course in other surahs, but especially in Surah Maryam. وَقَدْ يُقَالُ كَيْفَ يَكُونُ إِبْرَاهِيمُ بَارًا بِأَبِيهِ مَعَ أَنَّ أَبَاهُ عَلَى غَيْرِ دِينِهِ. Maybe someone may say, the Sheikh said in the book, How can Ibrahim alayhi salam be good to his father even though his father was not upon his religion? So we give, the Shaykh said, ayat from Surah Maryam, ayat 42-45. فَيُقَالُ إِنَّ إِبْرَهِيمَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامُ خَاطَبَ أَبَاهُ فَقَالُ. Ibrahim addressed his father and said. Of course, Ibrahim didn't speak Arabic, as you understand. But Allah, when he says, Musa said, Ibrahim said, he relates to us the meaning of what they said. So, Allah said, Ya Abati, relaying to us what Ibrahim said, Ya Abati in Arabic shows my dear father. So it's not good to talk to your father or mother like they are from the street. And we have in every language, all of us, we speak different languages. So in every language we have nice terms for father and mother, and we should try and use them. In Arabic we have Ya Abati, or my dear father, Lima تَعْبُدُوا مَا لَا يَسْمَعُ وَلَا يُبْصِرُ. He said, why do you worship that which doesn't hear and doesn't see? وَلَا يُغْنِ عَنْكَ شَيْئًا, and can't do anything for you. So he said, Ya Abati, this is second Ya Abati. Oh my dear father, إِنِّي قَدْ جَاءَنِي مِنَ الْعِلْمِ مَا لَمْ يَأْتِكَ. So he didn't say, you're a jahil and I'm a alim and I'm a prophet. He said, some knowledge came to me that didn't come to you. So this is also polite. فَاتَّبِعْنِي, he said, then follow me. As a result of that, أَهْدِكَ صِرَاطًا سَوِيًّا. If you do that, I will guide you to the middle path, to the straight path. يَا أَبَتِ لَا تَعْبُدِ الشَّيْطَانِ. This is the third Ya Abati. Oh my dear father, do not worship the shaytan. Many ulama said in tafsir that it means do not worship the other gods. Why? Because when you worship anything other than Allah, you have worshipped shaytan. إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ كَانَ لِلرَّحْمَانِ عَصِيًّا. Indeed, shaytan is disobedient to Ar-Rahman. And many ulama said, or we can say some, at least ulama said, that the fact that Allah used Rahma in this ayah, Rahman, the name of Allah, Ar-Rahman, and said that shaitan was disobedient to Ar-Rahman, shows that if the person is obedient to Ar-Rahman, he gains his Rahma. And if he is disobedient to Ar-Rahman, he is far away from Allah, Rahma, mercy. Then he said, Ya Abati, this is number four, إني أخاف أن يمسك عذاب من الرحمن. He said, oh my dear father, I fear that some punishment may touch you and come your way from الرحمن, from the most merciful. فتكون للشيطان وليا. If that happens, you shall be a friend and ally of the shaitan. So here the Shaykh said, فهل هناك بر بالعاصي أفضل أو أفضل من هذا البر. Is there any kindness greater than this kind of kindness? Even though his father was totally opposed to his da'wah, to his call. وهل هناك عبارات بنوة إلى مقام الأبوة أرق وأرحم وألطف وأحكم من هذه الكلمات. And how can someone find better words coming from a father to from a son to his father, and kinder and more containing more mercy and wisdom than these words that Ibrahim said in this surah Allah said about him. يقول بعض المفسرين رحمهم الله, some of علماء of tafsir, we learn inshallah Arabic, مفسرين, بعض المفسرين من some علماء of tafsir, they said تلطف الخليل عليه الصلاة والسلام. Ibrahim, of course, is Al-Khalil, one of the two close friends of Allah, the other being Muhammad, alayhi salam. Al-Khalil, meaning Ibrahim, alayhi salam, he spoke kindly with his father, مَعَ أَبِيهِ وَخَاطَبَهُ بِأَرَقِّ الْخِطَابِ. And he spoke to him very kindly. Some brothers say, when we say, for example, they say, how can I kindly say to my parents that they're on the wrong way? You try to wrap it nicely, of course. But to say kindly or in the wrong way, you try. You don't try to say it rudely, but you still have to say it if they're doing wrong. You can't, for example, say, MashaAllah, everyone is correct, like some people say. We all worship one God, like some people who are not Muslims, they may say to their children. Or some Muslims may say, this is new religion that you're doing. So how do we speak to them? We try to speak, not all the time, because that they will dislike. Anyone will dislike if you speak all the time about the same topic. And secondly, we try to choose kind words. فَقَدْ تَحَبَّبَ الْخَلِيلُ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ إِلَىٰ أَبِيهِ أَرْبَعَ مَرَّاتِ بِقَوْلِ يَا أَبَتِي. Four times he says, يَا أَبَتِي. وَبَيْنَ لَهُ خَطَأَهُ. Explaining his mistakes to him. وَعَظِيمَ وَخَمِ الْعَاقِبَةِ. And also explaining that if he doesn't stop, it will be very bad. It will end very bad for him. وَأَنَّ عِنْدَهُ عِلْمًا قَدْ خَفِيَ عَلَىٰ أَبِيهِ. And that he had knowledge that wasn't that was concealed or not with his father. وَلَمْ يَزَلْ مَعَهُ بَلْ كَانَ يَسْتَغْفِرُ لَهُ حَتَّى نَهَاهُ اللَّهُ. He was actually asking forgiveness for his father until Allah forbade him from doing so. Because Allah said in Surah At-Tawbah, وَمَا كَانَ اسْتِغْفَارُ إِبْرَهِيمَ لِأَبِيهِ إِلَّا عَنْ مَوْعِدَةٍ وَعَدَهَا إِيَّاهُ. That Ibrahim didn't seek forgiveness for his father except that he promised him. Because Ibrahim promised his father, I shall seek forgiveness for you from my Lord. So this shows that we must try and keep our promises. فَلَمَّا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ أَنَّهُ عَدُوٌ لِلَّهِ تَبَرَّأَ مِنْهُ. So when it became clear to him that he is an enemy to Allah, how can it become clear to him? Allah will tell him that this person will not believe. Your father will not believe. Because you've done everything and he will not believe. Then تَبَرَّأَ مِنْهُ, which means he dissociated himself from his father. Because his father was, Allah said here, enemy of Allah. وَأَمَّا نَبِيُّنَا مُحَمَّدْ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ. As for our Prophet Muhammad عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ, فَقَدْ كَانَ بَارًا بِأَبَوَيْهِ. He was also very dutiful to his parents. وَقَدْ يُقَالُ كَيْفَ يَكُونُ ذَلِكَ وَقَدْ مَاتَ أَبَوَاهُ قَبْلَ الْبِعْثَةِ. So if someone says, how can he be nice to his parents when they both died before he became a prophet, when he was actually a child? فيقال, so the answer to that is, أَلَيْسَ قَدْ إِسْتَأْذَنَ رَبَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلِّ أَنْ يَزُورَ قَبْرَ أُمِّهِ فَأَذِنَ لَهُ. Did he not ask his Lord Allah to allow him to visit the grave of his mother? So he allowed him, meaning Allah, to visit the grave. وَاسْتَأْذَنَهُ أَنْ يَسْتَغْفِرَ لَهَا فَأَبَى عَلَيْهِ. And he asked his Lord to ask forgiveness for her, for his mother. And Allah refused. Because you can't ask forgiveness for a non-Muslim parent. And if someone says, how can they be non-Muslim when they didn't know he was to become a prophet? We say Allah knew, just like he knew about the father of Ibrahim. So this hadith is in Sahih Muslim. فَبَكَى بُكَاءً شَدِيدًا. So he cried so much, حَتَّى أَبْكَى مَنْ حَوْلَهُ, that he made those around him cry. وَأَنَّهُ عَلَيْهِ صَلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ, and that he, عَلَيْهِ صَلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ, كَانَ بَارًا بِأَعْمَامِهِ, and he was also very kind and dutiful to his uncles. وَقَدْ جَاءَ فِي الْحَدِيثِ عَمُّ الرَّجُلِ صِنْوُ أَبِيهِ. And in the hadith Sahih, also in Sahih Muslim, that the paternal uncle of a person is like his father. وَقَدْ كَانَ عَلَيْهِ صَلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ أَبَرَّ النَّاسِ بِأَعْمَامِهِ وَهُمْ فِي مَقَامِ أَبِيهِ. And of course they are like his fathers. His father, I mean, they are the uncles. And they divided into three groups, the uncles of the Prophet ﷺ. قِسْمٌ آمَنَ بِهِ وَنَصَرَهُ كَالْعَبَّاسِ وَحَمْزَةِ. Those that believed in him and assisted him and helped him, like Abbas and Hamza. Abbas is the father of Abdullah bin Abbas. Hamza, of course, his uncle. got killed fighting for Allah in the battle of Uhud. قسم نصره ولكن لم يؤمن به وهو أبو طالب. The uncle that helped him but didn't believe in him, like Abu Talib. وقسم عاداه وحاربه وآذاه وهو أبو لهب. And the one that became a clear enemy to him and fought him and harmed him, and that's Abu Lahab. ومع هذا كله كان عليه الصلاة والسلام بارا بهم حريصا على هدايتهم. And with all of this, the Prophet ﷺ was nice to them and very eager for them to be guided. حتى إنه بقي عند فراش عمي أبي طالب حتى خرجت روحه. To the point that he stayed with his uncle Abu Talib until he died. Saying to him, يا عم أو uncle, قل لا إله إلا الله كلمة أحج لك بها عند الله. Say لا إله إلا الله. Expression that I can use for you to argue your case with Allah. And of course Abu Talib refused, as we know. This hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. So don't believe those mubtadi'a, those innovators who say that Abu Talib is a believer and things like that. It's not true. Also, after Abu Talib died, he said, لَأَسْتَغْفِرَنَّ لَكَ مَا لَمْ أُنْهَ عَنْكَ. I shall ask forgiveness for you as long as I'm not prohibited. And of course, Allah prohibited him in Surah At-Tawbah from doing that. He said, after it became clear that they are from Ashabul Jahim, from the dwellers of the hellfire, meaning died upon kufr, we can't ask forgiveness for them. Allah forbade the Prophet ﷺ doing that. And the believers. وكان يجل حمزة والعباس, and he was greatly used to respect حمزة and عباس رضي الله عنهما. فيجل حمزة رضي الله عنه في حياته قبل أن يستشهد. So he used to respect حمزة greatly. Of course, حمزة held special place in his heart, and he was very sad when he was killed. And even the person who killed Hamza, when he later embraced Islam, the Prophet ﷺ, and this hadith is in Bukhari as far as I remember, he couldn't look at him. He said, go away from me. Even though that person became a Muslim. His name is Wahshi. وَيُجِلُّ الْعَبَّاسِ رضي الله عنه وَيُخَاطِبُهُ يَا عَمَّا. And he used to greatly respect Abbas, and he used to call him, oh my dear uncle. وَيَقْبَلُ شَفَاعَتَهُ. And he used to accept his intercession, meaning if Abbas said someone, please for someone else, or he asks for someone else, he would accept it. وَهَذِهِ مِنْ أَعْظَمِ الْبِرِّ مِنَ النَّبِيِّ عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. And this is from the greatest kind of birr that we see from the Prophet also. Inshallah, we stop here because it's a bit, we've been going for half an hour. And we look at Sheikh of Tahara.